Welcome back to NYSORA YouTube channel. In this video, I will demonstrate the standard anesthesia technique that we use at NYSORA for patients having hip fracture repair. Let me preface this video by stating that all regional anesthesia procedures at NYSORA are standardized for the entire local regional team. Likewise, all assistants, fellows, and our staff are taught the standardized regional anesthesia procedures, the same pharmacological and equipment choices, and standardized patient management protocols. As an example, all hip fracture anesthesia during the day are performed by a regional anesthesia team using the protocols you will see in the video. And this assures the consistent outcome, regardless of who performs the anesthesia procedures. And even after regular hours, however, there are always team members and assistants who are fully trained to provide our standard of care at NYSORA Regional Anesthesia to patients needing emergency hip surgery. It is well known that the management of patients with hip fracture can be quite challenging due to the multiple comorbidities with which they present. As many as 30% of these patients may not make it longer than a couple of months after surgery due to the advanced age and the complications of their coexisting diseases. For that very reason, the anesthetic management and the avoidance of general anesthesia, intubation, mechanical ventilation, and invasive monitoring can make a difference in their outcome. In the video, we will watch the anesthetic management of an elderly patient with hip fracture during the teaching session with anesthesia assistants on regional anesthesia rotation. And our goal at NYSORA is to produce generations of anesthesia practitioners who are skilled in providing standardized, reproducible anesthesia care, even for the sickest and most challenging patients. And you can read about all of the procedures we will demonstrate in the videos in our NYSORA Regional Anesthesia LMS. As an example, we will briefly describe the suprainguinal fascia ILIACA block and paramedial approach to spinal anesthesia. These are all covered in a much greater detail in NYSORA's Regional Anesthesia Learning System, or LMS. So let's get started. The patients with a hip fracture are often in a significant pain and are placed in traction to stabilize the femoral neck, further tissue damage, and decrease pain during the transport while they are waiting for the hip surgery. So the first thing that we do before performing a spinal anesthesia, actually, is we administer a suprainguinal fascia ILIACA block for these patients. The suprainguinal fascia ILIACA block results in a spread of the local anesthetic under the fascia ILIACA towards the lumbar plexus. And you can see it on the radiograph how that dispersion actually happens. Well, this block takes up about 15 to 20 minutes to fully set. The analgesia from the block of the femoral nerve with this technique and its branches onsets within minutes, which really facilitates the positioning. For patients who come in a lot of acute pain, meaning on a scale greater than 5, before the block, we would administer 5 milligrams of ketamine S, which is a levoisomer of ketamine with less CNS effects. For suprainguinal fascia ILIACA block, then we would use 0.25% bupivacaine, 25 to 30 milliliters, depending on the patient's size. Larger patients would get 30 milliliters, smaller patients closer to 20 or 25, which we inject underneath the fascia ILIACA. And again, if you go to NYSORA's LMS, you can see the techniques of fascia ILIACA block into greater detail. But for spinal anesthesia, we use 10 milligrams of isobaric 0.5% bupivacaine, which is about 2 milliliters of solution. Since this solution is isobaric, it does not carry large risk of high spinal, and its effects are very consistent. This technique very rarely results in hypotension, which is important to us as we do all these procedures in our block room to maximize the efficiency of the operating room. So by the time the patients hit the operating room, all that there is to do in the operating room is the surgery. There are no anesthetic activities other than monitoring the patients and taking care of them intraoperatively. So let's watch the video of these procedures, and I will guide you through NYSORA's techniques for the hip fracture surgery as we teach one of the assistants how to become competent in regional anesthesia. So here we have a patient in a supine position. We have just released the traction on the hip, and we're trying to visualize fascia iliaca here. And in order to do a supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block, you really want to visualize the anterior inferior iliac spine. So that is the anterior inferior iliac spine. That's the fascia iliaca. That's a sliver of the sartorius muscle. Sartorius muscle, again, fascia iliaca. And again, the principle of fascia iliaca block is to inject a local anesthetic with the needle underneath the fascia iliaca and to have the local anesthetic spread towards the femoral nerve, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, but most importantly, more proximally towards the lumbar plexus. And that is where we get the blocks of the femoral nerve, obturator nerve, and the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. So it's entire lumbar plexus that we aim with an injection of about 25 to 30 milliliters of local anesthetic. And very importantly, in very small cachectic or sick patients, we might want to reduce that actually volume to 20 milliliters of 0.25% bupivacaine. It's very well seen fascia iliaca, that is the anterior inferior iliac spine, and here's the needle that goes in. So what we really want to do is it's an in-plane insertion of the needle underneath the fascia iliaca. You will see the needle entering that plane. We're piercing the fascia. And again, we can inject already there. However, what we really want to do is we want to make sure that that needle is very firmly placed, securely placed underneath the fascia iliaca. What really happens oftentimes is if you just place a needle there, it tends to indent the fascia, but not necessarily pierce it. And there are times when you will see how the needle pulls the fascia with it. So you can see kind of an indentation of the fascia. But the idea really is that we pierce the fascia so that we're underneath the fascia, but not inside the muscle. This is the iliacus muscle. As the needle now is entering, oftentimes you perceive a little pop as the needle pierces the fascia. And now we can start with the injection of the local anesthetic underneath the fascia. There it is. We first check that there's no motor response. We don't want to be anywhere close to the femoral nerve. We check that the needle insertion is underneath the fascia and that there's no pressure to or resistance to injection. And then the injection of about 20 to 25 mLs start. Now, once we are done with the fascia iliaca block, what we then want to do, wait for a few minutes, 2, 3, 4 minutes, until these patients get analgesia from the fascia iliaca. And then we will typically use 10 or 20 milligrams of propofol. So 10 to 20 milligrams of propofol on top of the analgesia that they receive is all that they need for comfortable positioning in the lateral position for the spinal in the lateral position. So let's see that. And now we're going to have a whole team, one person from the other side, one person from that side, and one person handling the legs. And we're going to position the patient closer to the side where the spinal block will be performed. So that's the right hip fracture. We perform the right supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block. And now we're going to take the patient on the side first. There we go. And once we're in that position, in a lateral position, then we're going to bring the patient closer to the edge of the bed. This is very important because if the patient is far away from the performer, it's really difficult to perform a spinal anesthetic. Most of these patients in our practice will receive a lateral approach or paramedial approach to spinal. And again, in this age group, we don't need to use 25 or 26 or 27 gauge spinal needles, which are very difficult to use, particularly in patients that have osteophytes and bed anatomy and things like that. And there's no risk of postdural puncture headache. So here we go, positioning the patient a little closer to the edge of the bed. And then now the preparation for the spinal will start. So typically we would start with injection of the local anesthetic for the skin and subcutaneous tissues. That initial injection for the subcutaneous infiltration for the patient's comfort also can be used to actually help us determine where the midline is. because a superficial contact with the bone would mean that we are not in the interspace. And here's the equipment that I talked about. That's 22 gauge QUINCKE needle. There's no need to use a blunt tipped needles. They're difficult to advance. They require an introducer. But here, this is a fairly quick procedure. We're aiming for the paramedial space. And as we're explaining that to our assistant, paramedial approach to the spinal anesthesia is much easier because you have more space, no osteophytes. And again, using a little larger needle caliber really helps you pass through those difficult small orifices to obtain a spinal anesthetic. The spinal needle is now in the subarachnoid space. We can see the flow of the CSF. We typically rotate the needle 360 degrees to make sure that the tip of the needle, that entire orifice is inside. Here we can see how the aspiration was positive for the CSF, and then gradual slow injection of isobaric 0.5% bupivacaine, 10 milligrams, which is 2 cc's, is really all that we need. And this technique results in a local anesthetic that is limited to the area where we injected. So you don't get a massive spread depending on how you position the patient. This is one of the reasons why we use always the isobaric spinal anesthetic for the spinal anesthesia in patients with hip fracture, because there's rarely ever actually hypotension. It's extremely hemodynamically stable anesthetic that we prefer over other anesthetic mixture. The spinal anesthetic with isobaric bupivacaine, 0.5%, 10 milligrams, in this age group would typically last anywhere between 3 and 4 hours, so there's plenty of time to wait until the spinal anesthetic onsets, which is typically about 20 minutes for onset. And then it's a very stable hemodynamic course intraoperatively. And that was anesthesia management of a patient with a hip fracture. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss our upcoming videos. And visit NYSORA LMS for a lot more information on the techniques that we just described. Until next time.